He's going to be first.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all very much for coming, which should be an exciting couple of hours. A couple of administrative housekeeping details. Would like you to silence your cell phones. If you would please do that, that would be great. Also, we'd like to ask, since this is not a debate, it's a forum, it's going to be a conversation, we'd like to ask you, except at the beginning, to hold your applause till the end. It'll give the candidates more opportunity to answer the questions. With that, I'd like to turn this over to the great dean of the Tuck Business School, Dean Slaughter.
Thanks, John.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, John, and good afternoon to everyone, and welcome to the Tuck School. It's a real honor for Tuck to host this forum at the intersection of business and government that is featuring New Hampshire's two U.S. Senate candidates. Our mission at Tuck is to educate wise leaders to better the world of business. Today, many in America and around the world believe, fairly or not, that there are too few wise leaders in that part of the world that we call Washington, D.C. A bedrock of any healthy democracy is a knowledgeable and engaged citizenry. Forums such as this event are vital for allowing a free and fulsome exchange of ideas between our elected representatives and us, their constituents, to whom they are ultimately accountable. And these forums are similarly vital for all of our students here at Tuck and elsewhere on Dartmouth's campus to succeed in developing their capacities to become wise leaders. I know I speak for everyone here in voicing my thanks to Senator Ayotte and Governor Hassan for making the time for participating in this forum. I would like to also thank at this time the many people involved in creating today's forum. This includes a number of campus leaders who are here with us today, including President Phil Hanlon and Dartmouth First Lady Gail Gentis. It includes Tuck Center for Business, Government, and Society, Dartmouth's Rockefeller Center for Public Policy and its director, Andrew Samwick, Tuck's Business and Politics Club, Tuck's Initiative for Women, and my terrific Tuck colleague, our moderator, Professor Emily Blanchard. But let me most of all thank our second year Tuck student, Caitlin Baldwin. We are all here today, most of all, because of Caitlin's creative inspiration in imagining this forum and her indefatigable energy in bringing it into reality. So with that, I would like to now reintroduce my terrific Tuck colleague, John Lynch, who, for those of you who might not know, is a former four-term governor of New Hampshire. John Lynch.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you very much. I have been teaching here at Tuck for about 3 years, and I can tell you I have enormous respect and appreciation for the quality of education that's delivered here at the Tuck Business School. And great affection and appreciation to the faculty, to the staff, and the students who make it all work. You may know that just today, The Economist magazine came out and gave Tuck the number 6 business school in the world rating, which is pretty special. Now, in a minute, our candidates are going to come out for the discussion. And I can tell you that public service today is tough business, very, very difficult. You know, whether it's at the Senate level, governor level, presidential level. And I think both candidates deserve our respect and appreciation for the hard work that they do representing all of us. So with that, I'd like to introduce Andrew Zabel, who is going to introduce Governor Hassan. Andrew?
Governor. Moderating today's discussion will be Professor Emily Blanchard. Professor Blanchard is an expert on the economics and policy implications of globalization. Here at Tuck, she teaches the core course, Global Economics for Managers, and a popular research to practice seminar on firms, governments, and the future of trade policy. Last spring, she was awarded Tuck's Class of 2011 Teaching Excellence Award. Professor Blanchard's research focuses on two key issues: the role of education in helping workers adapt to globalization, and the evolution of trade agreements in response to global supply chains and foreign direct investment. Prior to joining Tuck, the Tuck faculty in 2011, Blanchard was an assistant professor of economics at the University of Virginia. She graduated with honors in economics from Wellesley College and earned her doctorate in economics from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. A recently returned daughter of the Granite State, she grew up in Orford, New Hampshire. Please join me in welcoming Emily Blanchard.
Thank you.
Also joining us today is Maggie Hassan. Maggie Hassan was drawn to public service as an advocate fighting to ensure that children like her son Ben, who experiences severe disabilities, would be fully included in their communities and have the same opportunities that all parents want for their children. She has continued working to ensure that all Granite Staters have the same opportunity that Ben did, serving for 3 terms in the New Hampshire State Senate and now as the 81st governor of New Hampshire. As governor, Maggie Hassan has worked to bring together Republicans, Democrats, and independents to build a stronger, more innovative New Hampshire where education and small businesses drive job creation. She has passed 2 bipartisan budgets that protect New Hampshire's priorities without a sales or income tax. She cut taxes for research and development and small businesses while maintaining fiscal responsibility and created a business-friendly environment that has New Hampshire's unemployment rate among the lowest in the country. She froze tuition at state universities for the first time in 25 years and lowered tuition at community colleges. She passed a bipartisan bill extending health coverage to over 50,000 hardworking Granite Staters and worked across party lines to begin fixing our highways, roads, and bridges. Maggie will bring her bipartisan approach, common sense, and commitment to problem solving to the United States Senate to take on corporate special interests and get results for hardworking New Hampshire families and small businesses. Governor Hassan earned her bachelor's degree from Brown University and her JD from the Northeastern School of Law. She and her husband, Tom, who previously served as the principal of Phillips Exeter Academy, are the proud parents of 2 children, Ben and Meg. They live in Newfield, New Hampshire, along with the family dog, Honey May. And please join me in introducing and welcoming Governor Hassan.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. First question is, can everybody hear? Yes, I'm getting nods, good. Well, Andrew, thank you for the introduction, and Dr. Blanchard, it is great to be here with you. To Tuck, thank you for organizing this event, to all of you for attending. I'm looking forward to the discussion, and a special shout out to my friend John Lynch, who handed off the state of New Hampshire to me in very good hands, so thank you very much for your service. And Dean Slaughter, it is great to be here with you. I am really just honored to be here with all of you because being at a school like Tuck, which is such a leader nationally, internationally, so important to the state of New Hampshire, is just a real honor. Because of the work that all of you do here, faculty, staff, and students, we can focus on innovation and developing a 21st century economy that truly includes everybody. So I thank you for your leadership in that regard, and in particular to all the students who are here. I'm looking forward to seeing what you will accomplish moving forward. I also just want to take a minute to talk about what we have been able to do in New Hampshire, reaching across party lines to get things done for the hardworking families and small businesses of New Hampshire. Andrew listed some of the things. We came together, passed 2 bipartisan, fiscally responsible, balanced budgets without an income or sales tax that still invested in critical economic priorities. We are mounting a strong hands-on response to our heroin, opioid, and fentanyl epidemic. And we've come together and really worked on lowering the cost of higher education, freezing in-state tuition at UNH for the first time in 25 years, and lowering it at community colleges. We are feeling the impact of this progress across the state. One of the lowest unemployment rates in the country. CNBC just named us the most business-friendly state in the country. I think my favorite statistic is that more Granite Staters are working today than at any time in our state's history. And we've gotten here by doing things together and engaging in the kind of difficult dialogue that gets to compromise and gets to solutions. And I think it's long past time for Washington to take the same approach. So I'm running for the United States Senate because I want to bring that same problem-solving commitment to our nation's capital, because I know it is possible to keep our economy moving in the right direction, to protect our environment, and to keep our country safe. As long as we work together, I'm quite sure of a bright future for our country. So thank you all for having me, and I'm really looking forward to our discussion.
Thank you again, Governor, for being here and sharing your time with us. We'd like to have a conversation. And so to that end, I'd like to talk about a number of issues, beginning one of the most salient for this audience, business school students. So Tuck's mission statement is to prepare wise leaders to better the world of business. And many of us in this room, especially among our students, believe that business can and should be a force for good in society. But whatever their long-term aspirations, and for many that's in the private sector, but others in the public sector, others in nonprofit, most will begin working at the kinds of big firms, the so-called big business that's been maligned enormously of late in popular perception and sometimes in political rhetoric. Words like rapacious, unscrupulous, out of touch are often used to describe the consulting firms, investment banks, or multinationals where our students will go, candidly, immediately after graduation. And I think a lot of us struggle with this tension, wanting to do good while doing well. So my question is first, and I can sort of presuppose this, whether you believe that successful American firms have an obligation to broader society, and more specifically, what that responsibility looks like. What are the important things that firms need to do?
Well, thank you for the question. And I'll start by just saying that the progress we make in New Hampshire is progress that we make together, all sectors coming together, whether it's family members, business leaders, nonprofit leaders, elected officials. We all work together, and the business community in New Hampshire is a critical component of our problem solving. We're a small state, we know each other, and the relationships that we build have been critical. So I think in New Hampshire, we really can demonstrate that businesses who do well also do a lot of good, sometimes very informally, right? Mm-hmm. Writing that check to a local community group that needs some help, that does good work, sometimes in a much more formal way. And an example I'll give you of that is that we have a nonpartisan revenue estimating panel in New Hampshire. I need to have advisors on an ongoing basis about what we think we can predict state revenues will be so we can plan appropriately for our budget. And that panel is populated by many business leaders, academics, but also business leaders who volunteer their time to advise me and my staff on critical economic issues affecting the state. So we have a strong relationship. We also have in New Hampshire recently passed a law that allows a business to choose to be what's called a B corporation. So a beneficial corporation, meaning that they can decide as a business that in addition to making a profit, in addition to returning gains to the, whether it's private or public shareholders, they've mostly been privately held companies that do this, they can decide that part of their business mission is to do good. And that, of course, relieves that pressure that I think business leaders often have, which is if your duty as a fiduciary is to return on the investment, then what's your justification for making that kind of contribution? So now we've set up a law that allows corporations to choose to do that. I think my last comment would be, and then I'd rather go back and forth about it, is I think some of the terms that you hear people use to describe large businesses in our country and around the world have been particularly informed by the experience of the Great Recession, which devastated families in New Hampshire, around the country, around the world. And clearly, there was a intersection of new technology, new finance practices, and a regulatory environment that hadn't caught up to that. And it's not even clear that all business leaders really understood the technology and the new models and new devices, financial devices that were being used that ended up in a crash. So I think one of the things that the business community needs to do, while none of us like bureaucracy. And you know, one of the things I've done as governor is try to reduce red tape and taxes for businesses. It is important that the public sector and the private sector work together to make sure that there is not a race to the bottom when businesses start competing with too little regulation, mm-hmm. But that we also have thoughtful, innovative regulation, but also we have very capable and well-qualified regulators with enough resources to really root out the bad behavior, which is what has stained, in the eyes of the public, so many other businesses.
Great. So I hear you hitting on two really important ideas that are distinct. The first is making room in state governance as you have, and presumably this would extend to federal government if elected to the Senate. Making room for businesses to make choices that may not be in short-term shareholder interest, but are in the interest of the broader society. And B Corps are something that we talk about a great deal here at Tuck, and many students study. These are voluntary. These are, in a sense, government getting out of the way and saying, you know, we can define fiduciary duty a little bit differently, and then business is now more permitted to exercise good behavior, if we think of it as good behavior in society. But I want to push a little bit more on the other side, which is, you started to talk about this at the end, and this is a second point, is there a responsibility for federal government in particular to discipline, to either encourage good behavior, not just by allowing it, but potentially by being more involved, subsidizing possibly, or does federal governance have a obligation to penalize bad behavior? So other than regulation, is there anything government should be doing?
Well, and I will start by saying that in a democracy, especially our democracy, government is in fact what the people decide to do together. So while government can get big and clumsy, and you always need to be watching to make sure that it's not outdated and too big and too bureaucratic, it is in fact what we decide to do together. And when we talk about how we are going to police ourselves, essentially, that is when we decide what our priorities need to be and what tools we need to enforce those priorities so that, and you know, every profession, every sector of society has people who try to take advantage or who are careless or who are intentionally hurtful to others. And so you have to have a mechanism for addressing that, regardless of what sector you're in. It seems to me that, you know, we want to have an economy that works for middle-class families. We want to make sure that when there are excesses or wrongdoing, we can catch it quickly. And we know that we need more transparency, that one of the best ways to prevent bad things from happening is transparency. We know that we need to insist on better cybersecurity, especially with businesses that are really entrusted with people's life savings or information or health. We know that we need, again, to have a strong consumer protection voice, which I think is really important. And when you do that and when you balance it and when you have the give and take that goes with figuring out what's going well and what's not, you can develop a system that works for both businesses and the people you're protecting.
Great, great. Can I be a little bit more specific? You mentioned the word policing for firms, and you also mentioned consumer transparency. And if I put these two together, I immediately think of Wells Fargo.
Yeah.
Right. So John Stumpf resigned yesterday, some might say finally, after a long and fractious interaction with Congress. And Wells Fargo did something illegal.
Yeah.
And they got caught, and they got fined, and many thousands, I think 5,000 odd lower level employees were fired, not so much from senior management until Stumpf resigned or took early retirement. These are ex post measures, and it's not clear to me that a fine or an early retirement are enough to convince consumers and the people that that this isn't going to happen again.
Right.
So in just a minute or less, can you describe, is there any one piece of legislation or one initiative you think Congress should take to ensure that this sort of bad behavior doesn't continue to occur?
Well, I don't have a highly specific answer, except to say that, one, I think you are correct that most Americans look at what's happened and say, really, if I did something like that, I'd go to jail. And so I do think, and when you look at the crash of 2008 and 2009, the question I get all the time is, why didn't any of those people go to jail? So we need to find ways to hold people accountable for behavior that is essentially fraudulent at the same level that we would hold anybody who wasn't the head of a big corporation that way. And I think there are ways to address that by statute.
Okay. Greater accountability through legislation.
Yeah.
Great. Shifting topics a little bit, if we can. Another issue that is particularly important to those in this room, and I'll be honest, to me in particular as an international trade economist, is the shifting perception about globalization. You mentioned this in your introductory remarks, and I very much appreciate that you talked about technology and the recession and trade and frustration all together. What's clear if we read the newspapers, if we listen to our neighbors, certainly if we listen to the top of the ticket, there's a more protectionist, maybe closed, maybe not fully closed border, but cautious approach to globalization and borders than there was even 10 years ago, even 5 years ago. And I'm curious, where do you think that this anti-trade protectionist sentiment is coming from? What is the root of this?
Well, first of all, I'll just start by taking a step back. As governor, I've really worked to invest in improving New Hampshire's trade climate, especially we're such a small business state. So many small businesses don't have the resources themselves to develop expertise. But our international trade office is something we invested in my first budget in particular, and promoting trade has been very important. But when you talk about trade, you have to kind of go beyond textbook economics, right? You have to think about the geopolitical implications.
I agree.
But I think one of our problems, and maybe a slightly better way for me to say it, would be one of our problems is we tend to talk about these issues in the abstract. And you know, you have to talk about how what really happens on the ground with people's lives. So there's geopolitical implications to be sure. And then as Americans and as human beings, there are values that we're trying to protect here. So when you look at, for instance, the TPP, you know, what you hear from its proponents is the environmental and worker protections are so much better than past agreements. And what you always need to look at, you need to look at, is this going to help create more manufacturing, more jobs in New Hampshire and in the country? Then you also have to think, is it going to protect workers' rights and human rights, because those are American values that are important to us and are important to our competitive edge. Is it going to protect the environment? And lastly, you have to think about what kind of dispute resolution is there. And one of the things I've heard from a lot of people is, one, the concern that if we're going to do this kind of trade agreement, how are we going to help the people who are getting left behind? And you got to do both things at once. So you have people seeing a changing 21st century economy in front of them, but they don't see a place for themselves at all. That's a very scary place to be. I think a lot about my father-in-law, who was a butcher and worked in a wholesale meatpacking plant for most of his adult life. He would have said to me, if you take away my job, if a mechanized, you know, process can take away my job, what's left for me?
Right.
How do I support my family? So we have to do both those things at once. And then the other thing about the agreement in particular, environment and human rights protections could be improved to be sure, but the dispute resolution process seemed to many people who really studied it to be very, very tilted towards large corporations and not to the people who might be saying the environmental protections aren't being enforced here.
Right.
Though,
so we've shifted a little bit in it. We've gone from the roots of discontent to the Trans-Pacific Partnership. But since we went to the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and my students will know, thank you.
Yeah.
I wasn't going to do that, but now we shall. Let's talk a little bit more about that. So when we think about the TPP, there are costs and benefits, and you've identified a lot of these in very clear terms. So there's, what do these dispute settlement mechanisms look like? So what are the rules around the TPP and how will they be enforced? What are the new rules? Some might say the progressive rules involved in TPP, things that are in this trade agreement that aren't in other agreements, environmental protections, labor protections. This is new in one of these enormous trade deals. This is really unprecedented. And then the last piece is, okay, we do know that increasing trade, and to the extent that TPP does, it's expected to a little bit, not a lot, but a little bit. What effect is that going to have on workers? And so what's our responsibility to workers to help them make, say, a soft landing?
Yeah.
So I'm going to ask you to indulge me for just a minute, if you would. And suppose you could wave a magic wand and enact one policy to ensure a soft landing for American workers. And I'll make this a little bit easier. American workers who are displaced by trade or technology.
Right.
People who lose their jobs because they become, in some sense, obsolete in today's workforce. What one policy would you enact to help them?
I would continue the kind of partnerships we've started in New Hampshire between community colleges, business, and actually our technical high schools to make it increasingly easy for people to train for new skills. That means you've got to, among other things, expand Pell Grants. You've got to, you got to work towards debt-free public college to begin with, but for training programs, a little bit of investment by the public sector, matched by a little bit of investment by the private sector, and helping students learn what they need to learn quickly in a way that fits into their lives is really important. I've proposed something in New Hampshire called Gateway to Work, which is being a little bit held up right now because it's an election season, I think. But that being said, it's a way to use extra federal welfare dollars in our reserves to do long-term, short and long-term training for people who have been either displaced or at risk of being on welfare. And it also would help those people who are really trying to find their way forward into this new economy, who might need help with things like transportation and childcare, those services. So it's both training and then looking at ways to help make middle class families and working families make ends meet so that the transition is something that they can afford to do.
Okay, so a combination, and presumably this is at the federal level, is started at the state level. Presumably a combination of fiscal spending on education, skills, training, ideally in partnership with the private sector, and at the same time, other kinds of, is it safe to say, income supports for displaced workers or childcare supports?
Yes, yeah, so one of the things that we did, and Governor Lynch spearheaded this as we were dealing with the recession, when a company decided it couldn't afford to keep all the FTEs on that it wanted to, or that it had, and they were going to reduce people's hours, we changed the law so that unemployment benefits could be used to support the part-time delta there, and as long as the company kept the full-time benefits. Now, that helped the workers, obviously, sustain pretty much close to the same income with benefits. It also allowed the employer to keep people on board so when the up cycle came back, they'd have that full complement of employees. But the other critical thing is working with our educators, because one of the things we need to be able to do is train people relatively quickly. So we need computer coding, and that means we need to be able to figure out how we can train somebody to be an entry-level computer coder in a matter of weeks, not years. right?
So these are good places. These are places where you would want to spend federal funds, to be clear. Okay, great.
Yeah.
We have many students in our audience who are veterans. We have active military. We have veterans of DOD and the intelligence community, and they have many, many questions about foreign policy. So if I may, I'd like to get to a few of these, and we'll try to go fairly quickly. But first, I'll ask you, in just a minute, could you summarize how you view the role of the United States in the world today?
Yes. First and foremost, we have to maintain our role as the greatest economy and military power in the world. That is more important than anything else. My first job as governor has been the security of our state and the safety of our communities. So should I be elected to the United States Senate, my first priority as a senator will always be the security of our country. I've put out a whole national security plan, which people can certainly look up on the website, but it really focuses on how we make sure that we're maintaining our military superiority, how we also maintain our role as the greatest force for good in the world. And that means you have to work with your international allies while making sure that you also use your vast military might only as a last resort. So that's the general overview.
Great. Can I ask you a couple yes, no, maybe questions?
You can try, yeah.
I can try. So yes, no, maybe. You say it's important to have a large and strong economy in the world, as we surely do. Does this mean that you are in favor of more trade agreements in principle, yes or no, and then TPP specifically, yes or no?
I certainly support international trade. The agreements have to be done right. I don't support the TPP.
Okay,
as written.
Great. Thank you for your concreteness.
Yeah.
You also mentioned military might. Does this mean you would not cut defense spending?
I would not cut defense spending at this time. I support the military's request for a 50% increase in its budget for fighting ISIS. We have to destroy ISIS wherever it is, and I've laid out several steps to do that. But there will also, as we are changing the way our military functions, we know that we should modernize the way the Pentagon is organized, and that will change some of the budgeting at the Pentagon.
Okay. So
I think we're at about
the right place
with military spending right now, but I would support the 50% increase in what we need to fight ISIS.
Great. Support NATO. Continue to support
NATO
as we have. Okay, great. Let's push a little bit further. I'd like to talk about Syria specifically. And again, we don't have a lot of time to talk about this, so quick answer. What role do you think the U.S. should be playing in Syria? And maybe tie that to what objective, what should our objective in Syria?
Well, first of all, our objective in Syria and around the world is defeating ISIS. I mean, that's the first priority, among other things we have to do, is increase airstrikes. We have to continue to improve and increase our special operations. We have to surge our intelligence, both in Syria but around the world. We know we have to support and work with our international partners now, especially given what Russia has done over the last couple of weeks, to help them arm more moderate forces in Syria.
Does that mean arming Kurds, just to be clear?
Yes.
And Iraqi Kurds?
Yes, among others.
Yep.
And that means that we also, you know, one of the things that has been missing is that the United States Congress is long overdue in developing and debating and passing an authorization of use of military force that makes it clear to the American people what it will take. Now, what our goal should be is long-term stability post-Assad. But exactly what that looks like is still something that I think we're all trying to evaluate, especially now that Russia seems to have not only stopped being constructive when it comes to trying to get Assad to stop attacking his own people, but it also, you know, they clearly have gone way over the line in multiple ways in the last 2 weeks.
Do you think that long-term stability of the Syrian government, potentially a new government, is feasible without boots on the ground, American boots on the ground?
Well, if you're talking about ongoing combat troops, I don't support sending ongoing combat troops to Syria. Obviously, we have special operations forces who are there, who are in harm's way. But I think we have to be working with our partners to arm the moderate forces who can be most effective.
That sounds like a no?
Yeah, okay, great.
You mentioned missile strikes. Would you support, and if I can, I'd like to hit a quick laundry list because I have students that I know want me to get to these important questions. Specifically, would you support missile strikes against the Assad regime directly at this point?
By the United States?
By the United States.
I think it is much more important to work with our moderate forces on the ground.
Focus on ISIS.
There have been a lot of suggestions right now. There's a lot happening, so it is hard to be very specific at the moment. And before I forget, you mentioned at the top that many of these questions are coming from students who are veterans or in reserve. I just want to thank them for their service. I'm the daughter of a World War II veteran, and I am very, very grateful.
As we all are, absolutely. Great, thank you. Oh, one last quick question because I want to ask. You mentioned the importance of fighting ISIS in Syria, the importance of the humanitarian crisis. Aleppo is a tragedy.
Yes.
And by every indication, it's going to continue to get worse. Would you support the use of, again, U.S. military power in enforcing a safe zone over Aleppo?
I would want more information about how we would enforce that.
Okay.
So I know there are numerous proposals for that on the table. What is happening in Aleppo is a horror and a tragedy, but we'd have to understand how we would actually enforce it. The other thing I will say is that one of the things we need to do, whether it's defeating ISIS in Syria or elsewhere, is really help our European partners in some very critical ways and really develop our intelligence capacity around the world.
Great, great, thank you. You are an excellent sport about foreign policy in very few minutes. Another question I want to talk about briefly is fiscal policy. The CBO, the Congressional Budget Office, has some very dire predictions in their summer 2016 annual report. They talk about the estimated increase in the U.S. federal debt to GDP ratio, which now sits around 70%, increasing to about 141%. So that's doubling in just a couple of years. And I know this is specific, but I'd like to stay specific. And again, very quick, I apologize for that. It's very difficult to address the deficit, but everybody in this room, okay, most people in this room, are the folks who are gonna foot the bill if we do not. The younger generation, this is gonna fall on them. And so I wanna know, boy, it's been really hard to pass anything in Washington. Simpson Bowles in 2010 was the bipartisan budget proposal, you all hopefully remember the bipartisan budget proposal that would have addressed the deficit through a combination of revenue increases and tax cuts. If you were allowed to vote on Simpson-Bowles today, do you think you would vote in favor of it?
I think there were some, I'll take a quick step back. Fiscal responsibility is the cornerstone of everything. We have to balance budgets in New Hampshire. I'm proud of the fact that we have been able to cut taxes for small businesses and cut red tape and balance the budget and invest in critical economic priorities. And that takes a kind of constant process. I've laid out a fiscal policy plan. It's on my website and people can look in detail. I don't remember all the details of Simpson-Bowles, but here's one of my big concerns. We can certainly do a number of things to address our deficit and debt, and we should and we have to. What I think is really important is that we don't do it on the backs of our seniors and middle class families when we have tax loopholes, for instance, that we could close and that could generate revenue. Sure. When we have, for instance, with Medicare, the capacity to allow Medicare to negotiate for prescription drug prices and strengthen it and make it more viable.
Sure.
So that's just, those are some of the concerns I would bring to to the issue. There are any number of cuts we can make to eliminate fraud, waste, and abuse in government.
Of course.
And there are a number of things. One of the biggest concerns I have is that the federal government makes very few judgments about what works or what doesn't based on data. And so having data-driven decision-making in the federal government would be a really good thing. I'm happy to talk more about some other specifics, but that's the general approach I would take.
And I would absolutely love to, but Kevin is telling me I need to watch time. So I'm going to ask you one more question. Kevin is very stern. Watch out for him.
Yeah.
I have one more question that I'd like to ask you before we turn it over to student questions, because I know those are excellent. And it's about this electoral cycle. This Senate race is unusual. It is incredibly highly funded for a tiny state like New Hampshire. It's estimated more than $100 million will be spent by November 8th. It's also very prominent on the national stage. We know why. It's a close race. And it is potentially a swing race to turn over the Senate. That said, looking here and in a Tuck audience where 40% of our student body are women, I also notice it's kind of unusual and cool that it is two incredibly experienced, accomplished women running against each other. And so my question is, why do you think it's so rare that this happens today? Women have made great strides in leadership in both the public sector and in the private sector, but we're still incredibly underrepresented. What are the barriers that are making this pipeline so tough to get through?
It is hard for me to address that really specifically, but I will say this. I think, first of all, running for public office is a highly visible, competitive thing that increasingly people associate just with great negativity, especially when you see the advertising. And just so that I get to it and let people know, I would definitely support overturning Citizens United and significant campaign finance reform, something I've been standing for since my time in the state Senate. We could be, think of the good that could be done with the money that is being spent in this race. And that's a real concern of mine and something we should all be concerned about. But look, I think there are a couple of things. I think girls and young women need to see women in office so that they can imagine themselves there. I think that's one of the things that's so powerful about Hillary Clinton being a nominee for the presidency of the United States. I know that it was not something that was really seemed impossible to me, partly because I lived in a state with a female governor, right?
Yeah.
And she was one of the people who encouraged me to run for office and then mentored me, as did other women. I also think in New Hampshire, we have more of an opportunity to try public service out at a local level because we have so many volunteer boards and commissions and the like. And so women learn that they're good at it. And there aren't as many opportunities in other parts of the country. But more than anything else, I think women need to understand that the perspective they bring is unbelievably important. I know all of your students know that businesses make better decisions when they have diversity at the decision-making table, whether it's board of directors or top management. They do better financially. I think the same is true in government, and I think women need to see other women engage in the process and know that they can do it and do it well. And I will also say for all of the observers, men and women, who somehow can't imagine doing what I do, whether it's serving in office or running for office, or in New Hampshire, you tend to do both at the same time a lot, because we run every 2 years for governor. it's the best thing I've ever done other than marrying my husband and having my children. It is the greatest privilege. The people of this state are extraordinary. You learn something from them every day, and my mantra is just do what the people of New Hampshire do to solve problems in their everyday life. Follow their example, we'll do fine.
And thank you for the example that you set for my daughters and all of us. On that note, I would like to invite the students who have had their questions selected to come to the microphones and be snappy about it. And we have not a lot of time. We have about 15 minutes, so please remember, introduce yourselves if you would, but quickly, and ask your question. And so I'll just invite you to take it away. Thank you.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. My name is Sienna. I'm coming from Texas, quite a different background state. Just a broad question for you. I'm curious what your kind of largest goal would be as a U.S. senator, and what sort of obstacles would you face if elected?
Well, thank you for the question, and welcome to New Hampshire. You've been here now a year or two, but we are very happy to have you here. Should I be honored with the vote of the people of New Hampshire to become the next United States Senator from here? My first priority, if it hadn't been voted on and passed already in the lame duck session, would be getting emergency funding for our heroin, fentanyl, and opioid crisis here in the state. It was something I'd work on from day one and hope it would be the first bill the next president signs into law. The nation's governors have come together and really been urging the federal government to get us the resources we need to attack this problem at the volume it's occurring as effectively as possible. More than that, I think what we have to do is make sure that we have an inclusive economy that works for everyone. We were founded on the principle that every single American counts. That's really what our forefathers said. They didn't count everybody at first, right? But they did have confidence that every generation of Americans would bring people in from the margins and include more and more people in the heart and soul of democracy, community, economy. And they knew that when they did that, we'd all get stronger, both as individuals, but also as an economy and as a people. And so I will always look for opportunities to help include more and more people in the 21st century innovation-based economy, where I think the future of our country is. And I will also work to make sure that we are a strong and positive force in the world, because I also think that's essential to protecting our country and our vital interests. And I'll look for opportunities to make sure, among other things, that we also always take care of and protect the people who have served us, especially our veterans.
Thank you. Let's move over here. Hi.
Hi, I'm Josh. I'm a first-year student at Tuck. Thank you for coming up.
You're welcome.
As a senator, how would you balance the competing interests when a given policy is in the best interest of the country as a whole, but is not in the best interest for New Hampshire? And are there areas where you anticipate this tension?
Thank you for the question. And Josh, it's nice to see you here. Look, New Hampshire deserves to have two senators who always put New Hampshire first. That's our job. Granite Staters are also Americans, and they care about their country too. So I always believe that when you engage with the people you represent about the choices you have to make and the balance you have to bring as Granite Staters and Americans, that we can find consensus to move forward. There are specific issues that are very important to your state that you have to stand up for. I'm always going to stand up to protect the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard. It's important for our national security. It's important for our economy. And the men and women who work there, for instance, deserve our full support and gratitude. I'll also stand up for New Hampshire's economy. So I'd oppose, for instance, the internet sales tax, because it's just unfair to New Hampshire businesses since we don't have a sales tax. So those are the kinds of things where you can have a priority that reflects the priorities of your state, but are also important things that you can balance in other ways on national policy levels.
Great, thank you. And let's bounce back.
My name is Sam Goldhar. I'm a first-year student. I'm from Chicago, Illinois.
Hi, Sam.
Hi. My question is about the three Supreme Court justices who are now in their 80s or close to it. The next president is going to have the opportunity to significantly affect the ideological makeup of the court. And so my question is, what are your priorities in a Supreme Court justice, and how would they guide your participation in the Senate's confirmation process?
Well, thank you for the question. And first of all, I'll just start with saying that I think the current blockade of the Supreme Court nomination process is breathtaking. Mm. I don't know any other way to describe it. The Constitution is clear. The president shall nominate, the Senate shall advise and consent. And there is nothing in the Constitution that says except in an election year. And people elected the president and the senators to do their jobs in when they elected them all the way through their terms. In New Hampshire, we have a process that was really set into place, as I understand it, by Governor Shaheen. Governor Lynch followed that process as well, and I have too. We have a nonpartisan judicial selection commission that does the initial work of interviewing and screening people who apply for open judgeships. That commission includes lawyers, it includes former judges, but it also includes lay people and business people who then develop a list that they bring to me of the people they think are qualified to be judges for the circuit court, for the superior court. And I have made the commitment to the people of New Hampshire that I will not go outside of that list in appointing judges. So first of all, that gives the people of New Hampshire confidence that there is a nonpartisan, non-political process by which people are screened. And I think that that's critical. And they look for somebody, obviously, with the technical skills and the experience to be a judge, but they also make sure, and this is something that's been very important to me, I've asked them to address, that people have the character or temperament to know, to project in a courtroom that to all of the people, the participants in whatever litigation it is or process it is, that they will have a fair shake in that courtroom. I also think it is absolutely critical that any judicial nominee have a clear understanding of what our citizens' constitutional rights are and a real commitment to protecting them, voting rights being a critical piece of that, other critical civil rights that have been established under law. I'm very proud of the fact that over the last year in New Hampshire, I've nominated 12 judges. My nomination process is brought to our elected executive council, which is currently a Republican majority council, and 11 of the 12 nominees have been approved. And that speaks to the fact that it is absolutely doable to get bipartisan agreement on what a highly qualified judge is. And that's something that Washington should be doing too, and there's really no excuse for the fact that they haven't.
Thank you. Thank you. I think we have time for at least one more question.
My name's Kim. I'm a first-year Tuck student and a proud and new New Hampshire voter. I'm going to be a millennial and have my phone out to read my question. So
that's good.
It represents something we talked about a little earlier, which is how you view increasing Russian aggression as it relates to the United States' long-term interests. And then kind of more specifically, how you think we should deal with Russian violations of state sovereignty, such as the annexation of Crimea.
Yeah. Well, certainly the increased aggression of Russia is of great concern. Whether it's their humanitarian outrages in Aleppo over the last 10 days to 2 weeks, or whether it's the annexation of Crimea, they need to be held accountable for that by the international community. And it speaks to the fact that we have imposed sanctions onto them for their actions in Crimea. We know, though, that those sanctions are, in fact, having an impact in Russia. I think we should consider whether there are additional sanctions we can take. You probably also know that there is an investigation into their actions into Aleppo to determine whether they should be prosecuted as war crimes. So that's another action. But this really speaks to the importance of strengthening our relationships with our allies and some of our partners. And it's particularly important to work with NATO around a number of these issues. I have to tell you that I am very concerned that at the top of the ticket is a candidate on the Republican side who has suggested that we should weaken NATO and who seems to have great admiration for Vladimir Putin.
Great, thank you. I think we have time for one more question, though, if we can keep both the question and the response brief. Brian.
Great. Hi, I'm Brian. I'm a second-year student.
Hi, Brian.
One issue that's of particular importance to me, given that I've worked in intelligence for the better half of my adult life and specifically on counterterrorism in the Middle East, I would be interested in how you'd approach the issue of balancing the need for privacy in a free and open democracy with the need for high-quality intelligence to dismantle terrorist networks both at home and abroad. And more specifically, the issue of whether or not we've reached a point where we need to compel, or we should, you know, consider the issue of compelling technology companies to work with the United States government.
Yeah, thank you for the question. First of all, it is very clear that in the fight against ISIS and terrorism generally, we have to do more to surge our intelligence capabilities. And you know, the first duty of government is to keep its people safe, because without safety, and thank you for your service, by the way, without safety, we can't go to school, we can't have businesses, we can't live the kind of lives that all Americans want to have the opportunity to do. So we do need to do more to surge our intelligence capacity. We also have to work with our European partners, who I think have had some shortcomings in the way they share information. One of the things I've done as governor, for instance, is expand our information analysis center, which is really how we get information from local and county government and really share it, and then share it up with federal government as well. And that's certainly something we have to focus on. I also think that we should be having a summit with technology companies to really get at what their obligation and responsibilities are. They do have some responsibilities here, and I understand some of the concerns they've raised, but I am absolutely convinced that the leaders of those companies are good American patriots too, and we have to find a way to make sure that they understand what their obligations and responsibilities are. We also do have to protect privacy. And you know, there has always been in the history of our country this balancing that we do. And that's why we have to have processes in place to constantly reevaluate what we're doing, how it's working, whether some of our rules are resulting in stepping over the bounds too much and then, you know, tweaking them back. But this is one of the areas where we have to be aggressive and thoughtful and build consensus, and I'm convinced we can do that.
Thank you. Wonderful, thank you. And with that, I think I'll, thank you, Andrew. Thank you, appreciate that. With that, I'd like to give you just a couple of minutes to share closing thoughts, closing remarks.
Well, thank you again, Dr. Blanchard, for the conversation and for moderating, and to Tuck for having me here, and to all of you for participating. Before I forget, I was just talking earlier today to Colin Van Ostern, who you know is running for governor and is a Tuck graduate, and he said to me, remind all of the Tuck students to vote. So consider yourself reminded by your governor. Look, it's been a real pleasure to be here with all of you. Growing up at the breakfast table, my dad, the World War II veteran I mentioned, who fought in the Battle of the Bulge, would occasionally look at his three children and say to us, what are you going to do for freedom today? Which is kind of a daunting question to get when you're about 10 years old, right? But he was serious about it, because my dad was part of a generation that we've all come to call the greatest generation, who, by believing in a cause greater than themselves, saved the world from Hitler, and then built the United States into the greatest economic and military power the world had ever known. That is the spirit that I have tried to bring to my work as governor, and I think it is the spirit that Granite Staters and Americans want to bring to the kind of challenges that we all know we face, but we all know, in true American confidence, in our mission and in our history, that we're capable of taking on. That's also the spirit that should infuse our work in the nation's capital. And so I am working every day, both as governor and as a candidate for the United States Senate, to continue to move our economy forward, to continue to find ways to foster innovation, support job-creating businesses, and expand opportunity for hardworking families. At the end of the day, what we should be doing in Washington is everything we can to build a 21st century inclusive economy where everyone who works hard knows they have the opportunity to get ahead and stay ahead. And then when they do that, they'll also be part of a democracy and a government that will keep them safe. So we can keep our economy moving forward, we can protect our environment, we can keep our country safe, and we can do it while including all of our people in our shared prosperity if we're willing to work together and to remember that we all as Americans have an obligation to something greater than ourselves. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This was great.
Good to see you. Yeah.